All right. Interrupted there for a second. We're back at it. We are back at it here. So, talk about this again. So, a type 1 error means you reject this, okay? You think this is true, okay? So you reject the null hypothesis, and you made a mistake, you were wrong, okay? And then a type 2, you fail to reject this, okay? You should have rejected it, but you didn't, okay? So a type 2, fail to, is one way to remember that, okay? A type 2 error is when they fail to reject the null hypothesis. You need to describe a type 1 error and type 2 error in the context of the problem. The probability of a type 1 error is the probability of rejecting null hypothesis when it's really true. Alpha is your significance level. That is also the probability of a type 1 error. Okay, so if you're alpha is 0.05, then you have a 0.05 chance of making a type 1 error. Power. The power of a test is the probability of correctly rejecting the null hypothesis. Okay? So you reject this, and you should have. Then that's called the power of a test. The power of a test is also 1 minus the probability of a type 2 error. Okay? We're not going to go through how to find a type 2 error unless they give you the power, okay? Power is 1 minus beta, and beta is the probability of a type 2 error. So we're going to get into this a little bit. Type 1 and type 2 errors, we're going to talk about them, okay? So we're going to skip down here, okay? And we are going to, first of all, it talks about power here, okay? We're going to be tied up into our type 1 and type 2 errors, but you can go back and read this about power, how you can increase the power of a test. Okay, it talks about it here. So, one good example that I found to talk about type 1 and type 2 errors is the fire alarm hypothesis. You're going down the hallway in school, and you smell smoke. It could mean there's a serious fire. It could be nothing. Okay, so the null hypothesis that you make is the status quo, okay? You say there's no fire, okay? So let's talk about what a type 1 error and a type 2 error would be, okay? So a type 1 error is you reject this and you shouldn't have. So what happens, okay? You say there is a fire, okay? You go over, you pull the fire alarm, okay? You pull the fire alarm, the fire department comes, they go through, they evacuate the building, they check everything, okay? They check the entire building. So the fire department comes, checks everything, people are outside, okay? Everyone gets evacuated. So what are the consequences of a type 1 error, okay? Well, the fire department has to show up, okay? And there's a little bit of learning time that is lost, right? Okay, everyone's outside, they think there's a fire, they pull the alarm, everyone gets a little bit excited, the anxiety goes up, the fire department shows up, okay? And there's nothing, okay? So what happened? You made a type 1 error. You rejected the null hypothesis. The null hypothesis was that everything's normal. You rejected that. You said there was a fire, okay? So what really happened, in the most part here? An inconvenience, okay? So, what other mistake could you have made? Well, again, the null hypothesis is there's no fire. You could have failed to reject that, okay? You could have said, yep, no fire here. And then if you were wrong, what would be the consequences? Well, lots of consequences, right? You would have put people in danger, okay? You could have had property damage, okay? And you could have even had, you know, loss of life, okay? If there was a real fire and it was a really serious situation and people didn't get out in time, this would have been a type 2 error, okay? Why is it a type 2 error? We failed to reject that. We didn't reject it. We agreed. We said there's no fire. We said nothing happened in here, guys. Ah, someone must have burned some popcorn in the staff room, okay? Or, you know, maybe he was one of the lawnmowers down below, okay? Normally what happens, they say this, and I'm careful to say this because then we do some examples and it's not that way, but type 2 errors a lot of times have more serious consequences, okay? So here we have one more to look at, and it's called the Andon hypothesis. So we're talking about like Toyota, okay, and they have these assembly lines where they put their cars together. And then along the assembly line, they have this wire that runs the length of their assembly line. And they tell their employees that if they see something that's doesn't look right, pull that cord. And then what happens is the whole assembly line would just stop, okay? And then they could try to investigate what's wrong. So again, the null hypothesis in this situation is nothing is wrong, okay? So you're gonna assume that everything's running correctly. And what could happen, okay? What could happen? Nothing's wrong, okay? You could make a mistake. You could have said that nothing was wrong, or you could, let's do this one first. Let's say you think there is something wrong. You pull that line, you pull the cord, okay? You pull the cord. I'm gonna give you guys two examples here and you're gonna tell me which one's which. You pull the cord. Assembly line stops, okay? All the attention comes over, okay? So you pulled the cord, you rejected this. You said, nope, I don't believe nothing's wrong. I think something is wrong, and you pull that cord. And then you find out that you're wrong. You made a mistake, okay? Assembly line stops. Let's talk about some of the consequences. They lose money. They lose some money because production slows, okay? Production slows. Okay, so the company might lose a little money there while they're waiting around to see if they've investigated and they found that there's no problem, okay? Now, the other thing that could have happened is you could have agreed. Nothing's wrong here, nothing to see here, okay? So you don't pull the cord. Okay, and they go through and they end up producing cars that are faulty. Okay, there's something wrong with those cars. So let's just say that you were in the brakes department, okay, and you saw something, you go, you know what, that doesn't look right. Ah, it's probably fine. I'm gonna let it go. All of a sudden, Toyota's throwing cars out there whose brakes aren't working. What could be the consequences there? You could have serious accidents. Okay, you could also have to have a recall where they have to bring the cars to the dealership and the dealership has to fix them for free. Okay, so let's see what happened here. This one here, I said, I didn't agree with that. Nothing's wrong. No, here I said there was something wrong. I rejected that. I rejected the null. Here, this one, no, I said that's right, yeah. I failed to reject the null. Okay, so this is a type 1 and this is a type 2. Okay, type 1 and type 2 errors. We've got more to do with this, okay? We've got more to do with this. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna have you guys pause the video and I want you to try this one where it says faster fast food. Okay, so let's look. says the manager of a fast food restaurant wants to reduce the proportion of drive-through customers who have to wait more than 2 minutes to receive their food once their order's placed. Based on store records, the proportion of customers who had to wait at least 2 minutes was P equals 0.63. To reduce this proportion, the manager assigns an additional employee to assist with drive-through orders. During the next month, the manager will collect a random sample of drive-through times and test the following hypotheses. The null, P equals 0.63. The alternate, P is less than 0.63. Okay? So we want to do a type 1 and a type 2 error. Okay? So a type 2 error, we fail to reject. Okay? We fail to reject. We say P equals 0.63 when in reality P is actually less than 0.63. Okay? A type 1 error, we reject this. Okay? We reject the null. We think P is less than 0.63 when actually P is equal to 0.63. Okay? So now we've got to go through here and we've got to determine the context of the situation. Okay? So in this one, the manager, okay, decides the true proportions has been reduced when it really hasn't. Okay, so the manager thinks the wait time has been reduced, but it hasn't. Okay, that's what a type 1 error is in that situation. Let's talk about a type 2 error. Okay, so a type 2 error is if the manager didn't think the true proportion of customers who had to wait at least 2 minutes have been reduced when it really has. Okay, the wait time really has been reduced when we thought it wasn't. Okay, so let's think of a consequence here. So what happened? They're paying an extra employee, okay, and then they're getting no results. So they're putting an extra person on and they're not seeing a difference there. Okay, how about a type two error consequence would be it's not providing faster service. When they could. Okay? So, let's go down here. Faster fast food. Let's finish this little thing and then we're gonna have more examples of this. So you're like, wait a minute, I'm a little foggy on the type 1 and type 2 errors. Well, guess what? I got in your packets, we have some sheets that we're gonna practice, okay? Because this is important. So they talk about the same situation and they said alpha equals 0.10. What's the probability of making a type 1 error? Well, the type 1 error is the same as alpha. So our answer there is alpha is 0.10, which is also the probability of a type equals the probability of a type 1 error. Okay? So if they say, well, what's the probability of a type 2 error? We don't know from that information. We do know that as the probability of a type 1 error goes up, the probability of a type 2 error goes down. They do work inversely, but they're not perfect complements. You can't say, oh, so this is 0.10, so the probability of a type 2 error is 0.9. It doesn't work exactly that way. Okay, it doesn't. The type 2 error is more directly closely related with power. All right? That's 9-1, guys.